very, very much for inviting me. I'm really pleased to be here, and thanks very much for coming. Okay, so I've put Jenny Cheshire et al. On the first slide, and the reason is what I'm going to talk about is based on the work I've been doing on quite a lot of different research projects over the years, and I've been working with lots of different people, and I thought it was only right to acknowledge these people, so a lot of what I'm going to be saying is based on their work as well. So we had two projects in London. It's a rather messy slide, but anyway, the other slides I think about. The first two projects were based in London, where we found that young people were creating a new urban dialect. It's the one that Anna mentioned. We called it Multicultural London English. And then we did a project in Paris, where we found no trace of anything like that, although we were expecting to. And then finally, we had a project, that's the Athene project, doing several things. But one of the things is trying to explain why we had such different findings in London and Paris. And that's what I'm going to be talking about today. And to be perfectly honest with you, I've got no idea how to explain the different findings. So I'm just going to present what we found and then my thoughts about why we might have found different things. But I hope very much that you all have some ideas and can help me try and explain why we didn't find the same things in Paris as we found in London. Okay, so I'll start by just saying a little bit about the two projects. So in London, we worked in Hackney, a very multicultural, multi-ethnic area. I don't know if you know it or not, close to the city of London. Yeah, I don't know if you have to explain it to people in London. And in Paris, we worked in some suburbs, because of course in Paris, multi-ethnic, multicultural areas are not in the centre as they are in, not in the inner city as they are in London, but they're around the edges in the suburbs of Orléans, as they call them. The French project was quite a small project. We recorded 78 speakers, aged 8 to 19, as you can see. We recorded them with a friend, always, that they brought along themselves, and an interviewer. And the people that we recorded were what we call Franco-French, which means that they were born and brought up in France, in Paris, and then the non-Franco-French, who were people whose parents had come from another country, so they were immigrant groups, usually second generation. Sometimes they had come when they were very young children themselves, and it's quite a small corpus that they're analysing there. And then that was based on what we did in London, where we had lots more money, so we could do lots more there. So a very much larger number of speakers, more age groups, but it was the same way of doing the research. We recorded people in their friendship groups in the same way, and it's a very large corpus. And those websites are just in case anybody wants to actually hear any of the recordings. We've got a website there which has some London recordings, and I should have said there's a website there if you want to hear any of the French recordings. Okay, so just to show how very ethnically diverse the young people we recorded were. Remember, they brought their own friends, so their friends were from very different ethnicities to themselves. I'll just give you the ethnicities in the second project, because there were just too many people to talk about. They're roughly the same anyway in the first project. So Anglo, but I think I just said, didn't I, that these were the people of long-standing London families, so their parents tended to be Cockneys, and they were monolingual English, London English speakers. So there were 19 of those. And then their friends came from the most incredible, diverse range of different countries and spoke a very wide range of different languages as a result. So I won't go through them all, but you can just see how diverse they are. And then it was exactly the same, really, in Paris. So as I said, these are the Franco-French people, 23 at the top. So those are the monolingual French speakers. And again, a very, very diverse range of friends from different countries and speaking in different languages. So we thought that the two projects would have similar kind of results because they were based on similar fieldwork, similar types of young speakers. And we gave each speaker a score based on the type of friendship network that they had. So if suppose somebody was a Cockney, from a Cockney family in London, and all their friends were from the same kind of background, they would get a score of 1. And then if up to 20% of their friends came from a different type of background, they get a score of 2, and so on. And in London, in Hackney, nobody had a score that was lower than 3. Most of them had scores of 4 or 5. And it was pretty much the same in Paris. 1 or 2 had lower network scores, but mostly it was the same. So they were really pretty comparable, these young people. So I run through what we found in London, because then you can see how different what we found in Paris. So So this is what we're calling Multicultural London English. And I'm just going to play you a clip, first of all, from one of the older speakers in our project. So she's a Londoner, a monolingual Londoner who's lived in London all her life. And I just want you to hear this so that you can then see how the young person is so different from her. So she's just telling a little story about how she met her husband.
I was working in an insurance office and on the switchboard. And it was weird to see him coming in there delivering the post. It was a postman. The other little postman that used to come in, his name was Wally. And we used to say, Wally, what's his name? And we described, he said, you mean baby face? Because he was quite, he had quite a nice face. And with his hat on. So we said, yeah, what's his name? He said, well, we all call him baby face. But his name's Fred. So this Saturday morning, he came in with the post. And we're just chatting. And he says to me, would you like to come in pictures today, tonight? I said, oh, well. I said, where do you live? He said, Upper Clapton. And I said, well, I live in East Ham. So he came down to East Ham, and we went to the pictures then. From then on, we were always together. We were together nearly 40 years. And he was my dear, my first really true boyfriend.
That's nice, George, don't you think? Can I just ask how many people are from London? I'm just wondering if people are really familiar with this way of speaking. Have you got any Londoners here apart from me? No, I'm really glad I played that in that case, because that's what London speech used to be like. That's what I remember London speech as being like. And so I think you'll notice that this is very different. This is a young boy, Alex, from our recordings that I was talking about. And what I've done, the first thing to say is that his speech is incredibly variable. So what I've done is put in blue something which I think is just idiosyncratic to him. We didn't have any other people saying I didn't, not you, for example. And I've put in green forms which are traditional East London forms, like saying swang instead of swung, or multiple negation, I couldn't do nothing. And I've put in red what we think are the new forms, but there are lots of other new forms as well, which I think you'll probably notice as I play. Let me just play it and then I'll say a bit more about it. Oh.
I mean, I literally walked past two folks that I did not know, but they just grabbed me by the hood, swung me in the alley, and had me at knife point. And I couldn't do nothing. But I said, and they said, where are you from? I said, East London. That's where I'm from. They said, don't be funny, because I was writing a bit of East London. So they said, don't be funny with me like that, because they'll stab you. And I said, I'm not trying to be funny. This them, what area are you from? What part? I'm from Haggerston, Fields. And they just said, oh yeah, I don't like that area, where. And then like some hero, thank God. There is some typical heroes who, it's like, if you're short, don't even bother come over because you're just gonna get stabbed yourself, like.
Okay, so London's changed quite a bit since Joyce was living and meeting her her husband. But the language has changed incredibly. Did you hear the way it's changed? That's just in two generations of speakers. So we know language changes all the time, but it's really unusual for it to change so incredibly quickly. So I'm just going to run through some of the changes, just to draw your attention to it. I don't know if you like vowel charts. Actually, I hate them. This is the work that Paul Kurzweil and Eivind Torgerson did. But it's, you might have noticed the diphthong. So for example, when Alex said knife, I'm sorry, I forgot to do my little red thingy. But when Joyce says the vowel in knife, it's this one, isn't it, price, it's very long, a diphthong, do you see? And when Alex says price, it's extremely short, it's going the other direction, but it's extremely short. He says something like, he said knife point, he says something like knife point, something like that. And these other I won't go through them all, but his other diphthongs were much, much shorter, almost like monophthongs. So that's one of the changes which has taken place. Big changes in the vowel system. You can stop me if I'm going too fast, but I just flip through quickly. You might have noticed a difference in the rhythm. So it's very, staccato, syllable-timed rhythm in the young people's speech, and it's not, of course, in the traditional London speech. Did you notice that he said they swam me in an alley, whereas in I think we used in English to having to learn that when you've got a vowel coming after the indefinite article, you have to say an, and you only say when there's a consonant coming after it. Well, that's now merging, so they just say all the time, and the same thing is happening with the definite article. Actually, the and the are merging together, so they say the. Much more frequently than the, but all the time. Did you notice a new quotative? This is me, don't be funny. And then the new general extender. So Alex does say things like and stuff and that and everything, like I think most of us probably do. But he also says rare, 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 which is a very new one.
Can I just ask a question though?
Yeah.
Are you pronouncing a r at the end?
Am I pronouncing?
A r at the end. Is it rare, rare, or rare, rare? Because I thought it was rare, but I thought it had a bit of R-ness in his speech, wasn't it? Whether you were saying the r, what do you think he is? Is it rare, 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 or rare, rare?
Do you know, I think because the second, because there's a second R after the first one, I think I'm just running them together, and I don't know what he's doing. I can play it again to you if you want to.
Okay, I was just curious, because I thought it didn't have the R.
When I heard it, first of all, it comes after where he said, I don't like that area. I thought he was repeating that area. I thought, first of all, he was saying, where area?
The first time I came across it, a student told me about it.
Really?
So it wasn't something I heard, it was just somebody told me they say that.
That's very interesting. So that's really nice. So that confirms then that it's one of the new features. That,
Why did you say it
once?
Right, right, right.
Yeah.
It's called a general extender.
Oh, yeah.
So you and me will probably say things like, and they said, I don't like that area and stuff, or and that.
Blah, blah, blah. Something
or blah, like yes, or blah, 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 blah. Or whatever. All these different forms of use. What, rare, rare, rare? This is great. Good to know. I think I should be writing all this down. That's fantastic. Do keep telling me if you know these things. Do they say this is me and this is him as a, instead of they say as well? Great. There's also, so Alex didn't say this in that clip, but I really love the new pronoun that we've got in Multicultural London English. I'd love to know if you hear that around here as well. So you know that man was a pronoun in Old English, I think it was, or certainly in Middle English, and it died out. Well, it's come back. I mean, it has come back, but they've reinvented it, these young people, and sometimes people don't believe me, so I'm just going to play you this really short clip so that you can see it's really true.
Well, man, how my girl, I don't really mind how my girl looks. If she looked decent, yeah, there's one bit of her face that just looks a mess. Yeah. I don't care. It's her personality man's looking at. I'm not even looking at the girl proper.
So it's sort of an indefinite pronoun, do you think? It's like saying it's a personality you're looking at, or I'm looking at, or if you were posh, you might say one's looking at. So there's a new pronoun. There are new discourse markers. So one of them is you get me, whereas we might say you know or you see. And there are what we call camouflage forms. So in what this example here, the speaker says, my medium brother, who moved to Antigua? And he says who because he's marking my medium brother as a topic. So what he then goes on to do is have 10 clauses where he talks more about his medium brother. And if he was not going to say anything more about his medium brother, he would have used that. My medium brother, that means. Of course you can say either. So across the country, who is dying out in young people's speech? They're just replacing it with that. But in London, who is still used, but it's acquired this special function. And we say camouflage because I don't think you would notice it because it's perfectly normal to say who. It's just that if you actually sit and laboriously count up the number of clauses, what comes before who is mentioned, you find that it's used to introduce a new topic. So incredible things are going on in London English at the moment. And then there's some vocabulary. I think if I hadn't told you about all the other new forms, you might just think they're borrowings from Jamaican English. These are all borrowings from Jamaican English. But I don't think the other forms are all borrowings from Jamaican English. I won't go through them, just only a few examples. The point is that these forms are all used by young people with different linguistic backgrounds. And it includes the monolingual English speakers, those speakers whose their parents were Cockneys. But they are used more frequently by the bilingual speakers, but they are also used by the other speakers as well. They're used more often by the monolingual speakers who've got very diverse friendship networks. So we've called it Multicultural London English to reflect the fact that it's a multicultural way of speaking. It's used by people who live in a very diverse, multicultural, multi-ethnic area. And we define it as a variable repertoire of distinctive language features, like the ones I've just run through quickly, used by speakers of all different ethnicities. So we've called it a multi-ethnolect. We've been very criticised for this term, multi-ethnolect. People don't like it because the whole point is that ethnicity is not relevant at all because everybody uses it. But so maybe it wasn't a good idea to use it. But we needed some kind of term because it does seem to be a new way of using language, a new kind of dialect of English. So on the one hand, it's an urban dialect. So if you take a traditional definition of dialect, like the one from Peter Trudgill, he says it's a combination of words, pronunciations, and grammatical forms that you share with other people from your area, so these young people will share them, and from your social background, and they are all from the same social background, so it is an urban dialect. On the other hand, it also fits the definition of a contact variety, which is a language that's arisen by some historical process that means it wasn't transmitted from the parent to the child. And that is also the case for multicultural London English, because the monolingual young people whose parents were Cockneys certainly didn't speak like that. Young people from Turkey or from Cyprus or from Albania, their parents certainly didn't speak like that. So it also fits the definition of a contact variety. So we just called it a multi-ethnolect, which just means it's a new kind of contact language originating in European youth cultures, because it's not just in London, it's been attested in other centres in Europe as well, where there are very diverse young people from very diverse linguistic backgrounds, Berlin, for example. Okay, so that's London. Do you want to ask any questions? Or is that all right? So I'm going to go on. So I've called the next bit Multicultural Paris French, but actually I'm not so sure that it's the right name for it, because we didn't really find similar things at all. We did find some changes, though, and I'll go through some of them. First of all, I'd just like to ask, do people know French? Because if not, there's probably not much point playing things. I'll just play a couple of little tiny examples maybe. Okay, so in terms of phonetics, one of the things we found was the affrication of T and D before a high vowel. So I'll just play this little clip and you can hear it. So the underlined bits like here are where it's going to be affricated. So when I learned French, I wasn't told to affricate things at all. I was just supposed to say, we were told that the T was pronounced differently from English. I think you're supposed to put your tongue tip behind your teeth. But yeah, but anyway, you're not supposed to affricate if you're black, at least I was told not to.
Pourquoi je suis sorti?
Mais aussi, il faut qu'elle soit sûre de qui est là et qui va partir, en fait.
Right. Okay, so that's an interesting feature which we were very interested to find, but unlike in London, this was not used by everybody. It was more frequent in the speech of the non-Franco-French males, in other words, young men of immigrant backgrounds. But there was no correlation at all with the type of friendship network they had. It didn't matter whether all their friends were from the same background as them or whether their friends were from highly diverse different backgrounds. It didn't make any difference whether or not they used this feature. And some people didn't use it at all. It was only a few. And the other thing is it doesn't seem to be generated within that community of speakers like the multicultural London English features, because it's also been reported in other French towns far away from Paris. So I just put one reference there, but there are other references at all. So it's an interesting new feature, but it's not the same kind of phenomenon that we found in London. Then there is some vocabulary. So there are some borrowings, mainly from Arabic, but also from Romani and some of the African languages. And there's an awful lot of verlan. I don't know if you know verlan. It's this really interesting way of forming words in French, which makes it really difficult for a foreigner to understand what people are saying, because you reverse the order of the syllables. So the word verlan itself, which describes this way of speaking, is an example of it, because it comes from the French l'envers, which means backwards. So l'envers becomes verlan. And the same process is happening here. So the kerm is mec, but the other way around. And there's a few other examples there as well. And what is very interesting, I think, is that these young people had their long terms for all the different ethnic many of the ethnic minorities that live in their area. So they had a word for two words for black, one word for Arab, one word for Jew, and it's the French word reversed in each case. Another word for Chinese, Turkish, and then a word for the Franco-French people, which is Français reversed. And then another word for white people, which were also the Franco-French people, which comes from Senegalese actually, but is also reversed. So a very interesting set of terms there. Maybe it softens the ethnic label if you kind of put it in your own kind of way of speaking. But in any case, there was no correlation with the type of friendship network. And of course, using Verlon is a very long-standing phenomenon in the French banlieue. Many people have written about it, and these same terms have been used for a very long time. They were mentioned by Meredith Doran, for example, in her work. So it's not new. Then just a few other things. They use genre as a discourse marker. It seems to be the same as like in English, which is very widespread. So there's one example. They use quite a few new quotative forms. So they use genre, the equivalent to like. It's sort of like be like, as a quotative to introduce reported speech. There are a few other forms, like faire style, which means be like also. And then there's an interesting one, être là, which literally means to be there, which is also used as a quotative. It seems a bit like this is me, but maybe not the same. There are some new quotative forms, but these forms are very widely used by young people throughout France, not only in Paris, and certainly not only in the communities that we were studying. And they've also been attested in other French-speaking countries. They're used in Belgium, apparently, in the Swiss Romande, and some of them are also attested in French-speaking Canada. So it's certainly not unique to Paris. Just quickly mention one other form, embedded questions. So my syntax colleagues tell me that you certainly cannot have a WH form at the end of a phrase. You can't have a WH in situ, so you can't say, I know it's where, which is what you've got here, literally, but they do have it there. So you would expect to have, I know where it is. And similarly with this one, you understand straight away what person it is. You would expect it to have, you understand straight away it's what person, you'd expect the person to be further up. So you're not expected to find that, but we do have many, many examples of that in our data. But again, this time ethnicity is relevant because almost all the examples of this form come from male speakers, and they're almost all from Algerian origin, actually, some from other North African countries. Again, there's no correlation with friendship network. And it seems that it may be a developmental form because various French friends have told me that everybody does this when they're a child, but you get it kind of stamped out when you go to school, they tell me. So again, it doesn't seem to be the same sort of phenomena as we're finding in London. So just to summarise then, for Paris, certainly there are some linguistic innovations. And you would expect that, of course, because language changes all the time. But some of these innovations are used only by one ethnic group, and usually it's the males from Algeria, actually. But others are widespread throughout France and beyond, other French-speaking countries. And so we don't find any evidence at all of a multi-ethnonet in Paris. So we were very disappointed by this, because you get a research project, you're supposed to have research findings, and we didn't have any research findings, or not the ones that we were expecting anyway. So here are the two cities put side by side. Why should there be these different outcomes? Well, it's really hard to work out why this might be. I've been thinking about it a lot, and I've been reading about it a lot, and I'm going to put forward a couple of ideas to you and see what you think of them. But as I said, I've been really glad to know of your ideas about this. I'm going to talk about two kinds of things. First of all, about the individual people who produce the innovations, and then I'm going to talk about something that anthropologists call the longer view and embedded ideologies. See what you think about those as well. Okay, so I'll start with the longer view, and I'm going to look at just three aspects of this. I think they're probably all important, and they're all interrelated, and I've got three slides which I've crammed an awful lot onto, and I'm going to have to look at my notes because it's so complicated, I probably won't remember what I'm trying to say. But I'm starting with the colonial history of the two countries, of France and Britain. So the largest immigrant groups are from the former colonies of France and Britain, so and also they were the first groups of immigrants. So in Britain it was people from Bangladesh, it was people from the Caribbean, and people from African countries. And in France it was people from Algeria and from French-speaking Haiti as well. The way that the English and the French operated in their colonies was very different, and I wonder whether this might account for some of the differences. So in the, what the British did was they wanted to have an administrative class that could learn English so that they could speak to these people, so that they could get things done in the countries. But they favoured divide and rule. They didn't want the rest of the people in the country to be able to speak English because they thought it was best if they were just kind of kept separate. And so what happened is that for most young people, education was in their mother tongue. Of course, there were very many mother tongues in many of these countries. And so what the British did was they set up lots of committees and they standardised one language in each of the countries to become the language of education. So I'll just skate over the rest of that. It's really complicated, but that's the general way that the English operated. And it couldn't be more different in the French colonies. So the French thought their language was a gift for people. They thought it, I've got this quote here, they thought it was the key to unlock all the doors of French culture, and not only French culture, but for wider civilization as well. So they thought everybody in their colonies should have the opportunity to learn French, because it was such a wonderful thing for them to have. So there was hardly any education in the local languages in the colonies, and education was in French always. And actually, the education system in the colonies is still modelled on the education system in metropolitan France. And I think the legacy lives on in different attitudes to the English that's spoken in the colonies and the English that's spoken in the French colonies. So some of the French colonies are, of course, still part of France. They're the overseas territories. They actually count as part of France. But even in those that are now independent, there seems to be a lot less tolerance of linguistic difference. And if you compare that to somewhere like India, for example, educated standard English is now standardised. It has its own dictionary. It has a lot of attested differences from educated British English. And I don't think the same can be said of educated French in any of the colonies. So very different approaches then to the languages of Britain and of France in the former colonies. The next point to make is that these attitudes and ideologies, I think, get reinforced when immigrant children arrive in London, because the national models of assimilation or integration are very different in both countries. So in France, the Republican ideal is that everybody gets treated the same. That's what they mean by equality and democracy. So the national census doesn't even ask about ethnicity, because the officials think it should be completely irrelevant. So officially, multiculturalism isn't approved. It seems very bad. It seems American, actually, or British, and therefore bad thing to do. And so for language, what it means in France is that regional languages have been suppressed. And in towns with immigrant populations, using other languages is not encouraged. So the prevailing national ideology is one language, one people, and of course the one language is French. And this is really different in Britain. So I don't want to pretend that Britain is, you know, a wonderful, tolerant, diverse country, but it does have a different official line, and the official line is to promote multiculturalism. So I put up here a well-known quote from Roy Jenkins when he was Home Secretary in 1968. And you can see that he's saying that we will encourage cultural diversity, and that will be coupled with equal opportunity in an atmosphere of mutual tolerance. So there's a greater acceptance of diversity. So the French approach is assimilation. Everybody's got to be the same. And the British approach tends towards multiculturalism, accept that there are differences. So there are two other important differences, I think, between the two countries. And then the next point to make is that national cultural traditions are a major determinant of the educational system. And in France, everybody's got to be treated the same, as I just said. And so what it means is that children in all schools follow the same curriculum at the same time, including in the overseas territories. And if they don't succeed at the end of the year, they have to do it again. They have to do exactly the same curriculum all over again. There's a lot of whole class teaching, and the priority is to teach written French. They still do dictation in French schools. And then in England, it's different. I'm not an educationist, but from what I've been able to find out, the prevailing philosophy of education is that, so you can't treat all children the same if you're treating them as individuals. So the idea is that every child may relate differently to the teacher. Every child may learn in different ways and in different speeds. And although we have now got a national curriculum, and we had it long after France, France had it ages before we did, nevertheless, that curriculum tends to be delivered through worksheets, which children work through on their own, and problem solving. And a lot of the time, children do their work in small groups or as individual projects. I mean, there is whole class teaching, but it's not as dominant as it is in France. So there's another difference. And I think this is the final thing on this longer term view. And this feeds through into how schools deal with recently arrived immigrant children who don't speak French or who don't speak English. So in France, bilingual children are not allowed to use their home language in school. And by law, schools have got to provide intensive French classes every day for every child who arrives at school not speaking French. If there are at least 15 children like that, then there can be a special class with a special teacher paid for by the state. If there are less than 15, then the class teacher has to do the teaching, but they still have to do it, and they do get paid overtime for doing that. So the aim is that at the end of the first year after they arrive, the children can then be integrated into the mainstream classes, or 2 years at the very most. And so, from a linguistic point of view, there's not much scope for linguistic information for these children acquiring French. There's a clear model of French, it's the language of the teacher, and because a lot of the teaching is done through written French, it's very standardised French. And there really is, and they're not involved in the mainstream classrooms until they've acquired enough French for that to happen. And that is very different, again, in England. So in England, I'm sorry if I'm telling you things you already know, but I think it's important just to stress the differences. In England, the national strategy is that children who arrive at school not speaking English, they get included right from the beginning in the mainstream classroom, even if they can't speak English. And it's left then to local education authorities throughout the country to decide what they're going to do about teaching English. They get funding, there's a grant called the Ethnic Minority Achievement Grant, but they can decide what they do with the money. So it could be dealt with differently in different parts of the country. But however it's dealt with, the official guidance is that the curriculum has to be adapted. You should use bilingual teaching material. You should have bilingual teaching assistants who speak the children's home language. And then children should be encouraged to collaborate with other children who speak the same home language as they do. So it's extremely different. So just thinking about it, what would it be like for a young child starting primary school in Hackney, where we did our first London project? So one result of the British multiculturalism model is that it's really easy for researchers to get information about language and the ethnic diversity of a local borough. So we found this information on the website of the local council in Hackney, at roughly the time we were doing the project. And what it tells us is that in Hackney, first or second generation immigrants outnumber non-immigrants. So do you see it's the dark coloured bits which the lighter coloured bits which are above 50% of the population. These are the people of immigrant background who are likely to be bilinguals, therefore. And it also tells us that the majority of primary school children have English as an additional language, so they're acquiring English at school. So children who are native speakers of local London English are outnumbered in the schools in Hackney. So for them, London English is not very likely to be the target model when they're talking to their friends at school. I mean, they have to speak English to their friends at school because it's the only language that they've got in common. They're from such very diverse backgrounds. And then this, also from the Hackney Council website, tells us that the English which is spoken as an additional language in the primary schools is likely to be incredibly varied. There'll be Indian English, there'll be Caribbean English, there'll be African varieties of English, and there'll be all kinds of learner varieties of English. So that yellow section, I think it's this one, or one of the lighter sections anyway, it's called White Other. And so it includes Albanian, Turkish, all kinds of different ethnicities who will be speaking different kinds of language, whose parents will be speaking another language at home. And so the children will probably have language transfer when they're speaking English from their parents. So those among those who are acquiring English from scratch, there's no clear target model. Amongst the five-year-olds, we've found a huge amount of variation, and some of it gets lost as they grow older, but some crystallises, and we think that's a source of the information. And that's not happening in France at all because of the way that the immigrant children have to be taken out of the classroom and put in a classroom on their own and forced to speak the French of the teacher. So that was just a few aspects of the longer view. So it's sketchy, a lot of generalisations, but I think it makes it clear that the backdrop to linguistic interactions among children is very different in London and Paris, and it's because of the different history, the different political ideologies, and the different social factors as well. Any questions? Okay, I'm just going to move. Whoops, sorry, I think I just said that. Okay, so I'm going to just say a bit now about the different speakers and their interactions. So on the face of it, the speakers who are innovative, who use the new forms, whether they're multi-ethnic forms in London or just new forms in Paris, they seem quite similar. So in both cities, they live in multilingual areas, multi-ethnic areas, and in both cities, they live in very poor neighbourhoods. So Hackney, for example, was ranked second in the country on the index of multiple deprivation at the time we were doing our project. It's improved a bit since the Olympics, but it's still second in the country on indices of child poverty. So this meant that the young people in our project, for example, didn't have computers at home. They did have mobile phones, but smartphones weren't so widespread then, so they weren't able to use the internet widely. For Paris, you can't get this kind of information from official websites because they don't collect this kind of information. But University College London has got a few indicators. So this is an indicator of areas of unemployment in Paris, and the areas where we did our research are areas of very high unemployment. So it suggests that the young people were very similar in terms of the poverty of their area. They also had rather similar language histories. I'm not going to go right through all these, but these are just a few of the innovative speakers in London. So Don, for example, didn't speak English at home, but with his sister, he spoke a mix of Spanish and English, which they called Spanglish, but with his parents, he spoke Spanish. His friend, Rashid, came from Bangladesh. His parents didn't speak English either. At home, he spoke Sylheti and English with his sister, but he acquired English at school and from his brother. Alex, who's the speaker of that story you heard about stabbing, has got the most incredibly diverse background, and it's quite unusual. His mother was German and Scottish, but he lived with her and his stepfather, who was from Antigua, and then his stepfather moved out. And since then, he lived with his grandmother and her second husband, who were from Malta. His father was half Maltese and half Ghanaian, and there's a huge mix of languages in his background. You can just see how diverse it is. And then there is Zach, Alex's best friend, who is Anglo, whose parents are Cockney speakers, but he has an extremely diverse friendship group. And then comparing that with Paris, they are similarly diverse in their linguistic background, but something which I think is quite interesting is that Amy, for example, at home speaks only French. Although she has other languages in her background. Her friend Hortense also speaks French at home, but she also speaks French Creole. Their friend Carla also speaks mainly French at home, but they also speak other languages at home. And then Sami, an Algerian, speaks Arabic and French at school. Most of them are learning other languages at school, other European languages. And then Sami's friend is one of the rare ones who doesn't speak French at home. So they're sort of similar in having, they're similar in having diverse multi-ethnic friendship groups, but most they're similar in being multilingual, and they're also similar in being extremely talkative. There's been research by Derek Dennis which shows that people who use new forms, innovations, are people who are extremely talkative. And I don't think it's just that it means that linguists are able to record a lot of speech for them, and so they're more likely to be able to record the innovations. It seems that they have a lot of diverse contacts, and they say a lot, and so they're more likely to be innovative in their speech. So they share all these characteristics in young people. But this is two ways in which they're different. In Paris, ethnic labels are often used. So remember all those terms I ran through from Verlong. So it seems that ethnic diversity is quite salient for them, but defined in their own terms. I mean, and that seems to be a reaction to the way that at school they're told they've all got to be the same, they've all got to be French, and they're all the same. Of course, they're not. it's not really the same. They're much more likely to be stopped and searched by the police, for example, if they look as if they're Arabs or if they're black, just like in London. But this, the official ideology is that everybody is all the same. So the veil on terms seem to me that young people can stress the diversity of their neighbourhood to each other, but they define it in their own terms by using their own labels for it. And the other thing that we noticed in our data is that they sometimes use the mainstream ethnic labels, for example, like Arab in this example here, but they use it playfully when they're when they're teasing each other. So here, what happened is that Sami came late for the recording. So he was late for the thing that had been set up by the interviewer. And he came in running. And his friend Nizar said to him, I'm considering English. He said, you've been running, I knew you'd forget. And his other friend said, you're a real Arab. So his friend is an Arab as well. They're both of Algerian background. And then the other friend says, always late, that Arab. And then his friend just says, so hello, sorry, I was thinking in the PlayStation. So they kind of reinforce them, or they use what they know are the national stereotypes to each other, jokingly. So ethnicity seems to be sort of salient for them. And also when they're speaking, they sometimes mimic African accents and Caribbean accents, even when they're talking to somebody who isn't from those parts of the world at all. What's interesting is that popular stand-up comics and actors who are performing a banlieue identity do exactly the same thing. So I don't know if you know these people, those of you who know French. These are comics and actors who have got a sort of banlieue identity. They're very popular in France, and the young people talked about them a lot and really liked what they did. So in their performances, they do the similar kind of thing. They mix languages. They use a lot of Velon. They use a bit of African-accented French. They use sometimes bits of other languages as well, English even, as well. So it seems that what the young people are doing and what these personalities have kind of noticed that is done and are playing on it is expressing an orientation to an urban identity, and that's to a multilingual, multicultural urban identity by performing different languages and by mentioning all the different ethnicities that exist. Yes, I'd like to know what you think about that, but let me just say what happens in London. In London, race and ethnicity hardly ever get mentioned by the young people, in our data anyway. Sometimes the interviewer pressed them to see what they thought about it. They said, for example, what ethnicity are you? And they said, don't really know what you're talking about. Do you mean like in the census or something? But when he pressed them, they sometimes mentioned black or white or Asian. But I think this little quote is quite telling. So this is Amber, who lives somewhat outside the area. And she's talking about her, people sometimes say that people from Hackney sound black. Because those vowels and things that you heard, they think are the way that black people speak. But so she's talking about her her cousin, who's a white boy like her. So she says he's only 8. He don't speak like that because he wants to be black, and he hears black people saying it. That's just the way he talks. And then the interviewer says, is that the way everybody talks? And Amber says, yeah, it's the way he's been brought up, talking with the accent. And the interviewer says, white and black boys. And she says, that's just like having a northern accent or something, because you were brought up like it. So it's just the local way of talking. It's got nothing to do with ethnicity. And I'll just play this clip. I think it's nice because it suggests how a young Bangladeshi speaker sees Londoners. So this is, we've called her Serena. She's talking about the bomb that went off on a London bus, and she's seeing something positive.
When disasters happen, like public and national things happen, that's when people come together and no longer see it as us being a different race, because at the end of the day, people that were on the bus were all different types of people, so therefore all different types of families got affected by the same thing. So natural and national disasters that happen in Britain, everyone feels it. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I think, like religiously speaking, sometimes I think like them things should happen, but there is still a benefit from like disasters, because people do come together and we realize that people do get affected. So yeah, so I'm definitely a Londoner.
So she was quite typical of young people in our project, not typical of thinking that disasters should happen, but she's typical of seeing herself as having things in common with other people from a wide range of different linguistic and cultural backgrounds. They all see themselves first and foremost as Londoners. So being London is having a multi-ethnic, multicultural identity. And I mentioned these performers in Paris. So the features of multicultural London English also seem to be taken up by various performers to have a sort of social meaning. So I don't know if you know the film Anotherhood, and there are other films like that, where there are young actors who are portraying themselves as being cool and tough, and they speak, they all use multicultural London English. And I don't know if you know Phone Shop, the TV comedy series, so that was set in South London, I think, and again, the actors were using a lot of multicultural London English features. So it seems to have taken on the image of being a way of portraying yourself as a real Londoner. And then for some young people in London who don't speak multicultural London English naturally, they tend to sort of lapse into it when they're talking with their friends, when they want to project a sort of persona that's cool and tough. So it certainly seems to have taken on a social meaning. And then very quickly, I've almost finished, I just want to mention that that the actual things that the young people in our data talk about is different. So in London, the young people talk a lot about local conflicts, confrontations and fights, like the example I played you from Alex. That's a really typical story that the young people talk. They talk about their everyday lives and their bad experiences when they're at school. They do talk a bit about rapping as well. In Paris, there's a much greater focus on more mainstream topics. So they talk quite a lot about their school work. They seem quite oriented to the school. They talk about their teachers. They talk about politics, although it was mainly about Marine Le Pen and how they didn't want her to get in. They talk about their football team, and they talk about English football teams as well. They talk about Real Madrid. They talk about football players. They might be a bit dated, but they're from other countries. They talk about the games they play on their PlayStations, which I think are the same kind of games that my grandson plays on his PlayStation. So they're much more oriented to the wider world than the young people we recorded in London, certainly what they talk about anyway. And they also mentioned lots of other countries in their conversations with each other as well. And another difference is the fact that they, in Paris, they travel beyond the neighbourhood. So Amy, the young girl that I mentioned, goes to central Paris to see her father, who lives there. She goes to various places in Africa to see her various family members. She's got a German pen friend. Do you remember she's learning German at school? She's been to visit her pen friend in Cologne, and she's in touch with her on Facebook, so she communicates with her quite regularly. And she's been to London for 2 weeks with the school. And then the Algerian young boy that I mentioned, Sami, goes outside his area to see his father. They're almost all divorced families, these people. He goes to Algeria to see his family, but he also goes to Naples, and he's hoping to go to Spain, and he's travelled also within France as well. It's so unlike the London speakers. So most of the London speakers do go to other countries to visit their family, but they rarely go into central London, and they rarely travel beyond their very immediate neighbourhood. And it's because of the kind of things that Alex was talking about. When you get into trouble if you go into a different area, there are these postcode wars. So they're really quite isolated. They rarely travel. So I think I just sum up on the differences. There are differences then in the amount and extent of travel beyond the neighbourhood. There are differences into the extent of their integration into the mainstream culture, at least as far as we could tell from the topics that were discussed in our recordings. And there's a difference in the diversity of their contacts, which they make as a result of their travel, because in Paris, the young boys belong to a football team and go off to play with teams from other places, and they have friends on Facebook. So these are my tentative conclusions. So there are very similar processes of population movement between Paris and London, but these processes have produced different linguistic outcomes in the two cities. So in both cases, there's language innovation and language change, which is what you would expect, because you get people speaking differently coming together. But I think that the large-scale ideologies, the things that I was talking about to do with colonial history and so on, they determine the specific kinds of innovation and change which are likely to happen, and of course what happened in the schools is crucially important as well. But I think the orientation of speakers to their local neighbourhood is also important. If you're very localised and very looking inwards to your local neighbourhood, you're going to forge identities with other people from your neighbourhood, and it's quite possible for something like multicultural London English to develop. And I think I'll just skip through those bits. I'd really like to hear what your views are on why there should be these differences. It would help me quite a lot. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, be right down.
I'm wondering to what extent there's been research looking at attitudes to different varieties among these young people. Because one of my thoughts was, if sort of standardish or perceived as standard forms of French
yes.
are thought of less negatively by young people in Paris than they are in London, or if that's been something people have thought about. Because
yes.
it's a lot about identity, isn't it?
Yes.
I sometimes think the London kids want to identify themselves as
not
speaking like certain
people. Yes. Well, I don't know about other people's research, but we did some research in, we went into schools in Paris as part of the impact part of the project, and we talked to the young people about the forms. We gave them a questionnaire with the forms that we used and asked what they thought about them, and they all said, no, you can't possibly use these forms, I didn't use them, but they did.
Mm-hmm.
So they all thought that they were not the sort of forms that you should use, so I think maybe you've maybe put your finger on something there. The young people in London talked about the forms they used. They just said it was slang. They seemed to think it was slang.
Yeah.
And they said that when they left the area, if they did leave the area and go to talk to other people, they would have to straighten up their English, is what they said. They'd have to kind of leave out some of the words that they use. So yeah, I think attitude is important, thank you. The question is why that the attitudes would be like.
Well, it came to my head partly thinking about what you were saying about the educational context, because
yeah.
the first thing in my head was surprising to think that the way schools are set up would actually have an impact, isn't it?
Yes.
I had been kind of thinking language change just always happens and kids make their identities. And
yes, that's why I was surprised that we didn't find anything like this in Paris, because
yeah.
people said, well, there's the Académie Française and France is always different and France is so normative, and I've always thought, yeah, you just say that, but of course nobody cares about the way they speak French when you're just speaking to your friends on the streets. But I mean, they do speak very fast, and there are a lot of there's an awful lot of Vélan in their speech, which I don't think they would do at school at all.
Yeah.
But yeah, it does seem to produce differences. Yeah, they seem so oriented to school. I was really surprised by that as well.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas the young people in London had mostly been thrown out of school because their behaviour had been so bad. You know? I'm sorry, I don't know your name.
Paul, but 20 years ago, this is just a comment to affirm some of your conclusions. 20 years ago, I was researching in exactly the same area in Hackney with broadly the same age group, and we've been on this project for about 5 years, and repeatedly we kept finding that when we tried to broach issues to do with ethnicity. One of the things that stopped people discussing ethnicity across London was that they found that places like Brixton were foreign countries.
Yes.
You know, and that's 20 years ago that had already been established. They thought that to go to Brixton, to go to their cousin's house, you know, it was all different there. All the cultural choices that they made, the way that they spoke, the way that they behaved and dressed.
Mm-hmm.
I was quite surprised, but like, to have this confirmed many years later is reassuring, actually.
I don't know what's happening in Brixton at the moment, actually. I wonder whether that's become more diverse. But, yeah.
I don't know, but it was perceived as a very different place.
Yes. All these young people never go as far as Brixton. It would be like another country to them. Absolutely right. Yeah. Yeah. And how long ago was that? 5 years ago.
This was from about 1994 to 1999.
Yes, because interesting, there was linguistic research in the same area, Hackney, in the 70s by someone called Mark Sever, when it was much less diverse, but there were a lot of young people from the Caribbean who had arrived. And what these young people did was code switch between Patois, Caribbean Creole, and London English. But there was none of these diversity that we find today. I mean, they were the main group that was there, and for a few others. So I think something's changed in, since the 70s.
Thank you very much. It was very interesting. Two remarks. One is just about my own experience. When you talked about young people define themselves as Londoners rather than anything else. I'm Dutch and my children grew up here, but a few years ago, we talked about, do you feel Londoner or British or Dutch? And they said, we feel like we're Dutch Londoners. And I had to think of that when you were talking about this. So I think it's definitely something that I would relate to my own experience.
They didn't say Dutch British.
No, definitely not. We never called themselves British, but they would say that they were Dutch Londoners.
Yes.
And they expressly said that.
Yes.
So I sort of had to raise that. My question or my observation is around this. It seemed to me that in both cases, the French and the London case, there is actually, that's my question, isn't there in both cases a kind of repetition of the dominant ideology? So in the case of the London multi-ethnolect, there is a repetition or an embodiment of the ideology of divide and rule. And you see that in the post-Cold Wars, you see that in the fact that they don't travel. It's almost like British imperialism on a small scale, and therefore also the spontaneous emergence of a new idiolect or a new dialect is exactly in line with the language policy that you described. And it's exactly the same thing in the French case, where the most illustrative example that you gave was L'Envers, which is a word play. So it's not a real grammatical innovation or change, but it's a play with words.
Yeah.
And of course, and it's a play with the standard form. It's a kind of subversion that has no effect, because it actually just reinforces the standard language, because it only works as a play on the standard language.
Yes.
Yeah? And it's exactly the same in the London case. So these young people are just instantiating dominant ideology without realizing that they are doing it.
That's a really interesting way of thinking about it. I hadn't thought of it that way at all. I've been thinking that maybe the young people in London were sort of reinforcing the multiculturalism which is the official ideology. But then I couldn't quite work out why the French young people are not reinforcing that we're all the same.
But they are. Person. Yeah, they are, because they are.
They are, because they're only doing it by word play, not by.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
Really, really. Yeah. Yes, thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Can anybody else help me out?
I might chuck one in. Just another example. Do you know Chanmé? It's méchant, which means naughty.
Okay, naughty.
But dans l'avant, it becomes Chanmé.
Yes.
But it also has the bad meaning good thing. So Chanmé means cool.
Yeah.
And I was told it by somebody who lives in Brussels when I was in Lille. Because somebody said, what are the kids in France and Belgium saying these things? But it's all Chanmé. And then that day I heard it in Lille. And, you know, a bit of Googling, I can see it's all over French-speaking Europe.
Yeah.
And so I wonder if that's also evidence that it's very quickly everywhere.
Yes.
Rather than
yes.
Something in London would be in London. Things have spread a bit, haven't they? So some of these multicultural things happen in Manchester and other cities, don't they?
Yes, exactly.
But it feels like that one is almost instant.
Yes, and that is interesting. I don't know how it's spread so fast in the French-speaking world. Yeah. But it's true, what Billy says, so there's somebody called Rob Drummond who's been doing some research in Manchester in a similar kind of community that we've been working in, and he finds that many of the same features that we've found are used by these young people as well. Not all of them, so they don't use the "this is me" quotative for some reason. That seems to be just London, but many of them are used as well. The young people seem to have a Manchester accent, but they also have some of the vowels that we find in London as well, many of the other features. So then the question arises whether has it diffused from London or in some other way, or has it been created independently in Manchester? And I don't quite know how we could find out the answer to that.
because it can't be as absolute as there are postcode wars, so I literally never cross that road.
No.
Some people will be going to Natchez.
Yes, yes. If you look at contact scenarios in the past, so people who work on the birth of creoles, language creoles, are usually quite interested in our research because they say that we have the same kind of situation in London that you find in creole communities. For example, when you get lots of people speaking different languages, being forced to live together, and they have no common language, so they kind of create one themselves from the dominant language in the host community. But you have to just speculate on what's going on in the past. But of course, we can actually see what's going on right at this moment. So, and I think to some extent, the situation in Hackney resembles what happens in Creole communities in terms of the social isolation that people live. And maybe, so maybe, you know, the same thing happens in similar communities in Manchester, so things are created anew, because the actual forms that are created are not linguistically unusual from a typological point of view. They're only unusual from, if you look at it from the sort of dialectology point of view, because they're new to London.
Is this a youth language, or do you think, or is it a so when the informants are 70, will they still speak this way?
I don't know. So we actually tried to find the London informants to see what was going on, and we could only find one of them. All their mobile phones didn't work, and more the numbers had sort of changed. Mm-hmm. But we found one, and he'd gone to live in Portsmouth, and he'd become an estate agent. And he seemed to have the same vowels, but he wasn't using any of the other features. But it was just a phone call, you know. His vowels seemed to be fit. So, yeah. So I do wonder whether perhaps, you know, the phonetics might be the same. Yeah, but you have to speculate. We need to do some more studies now and see what's happening with older people, older Londoners.
I think Ben Rampton and his group did some studies, mm-hmm. looked at this, I think it was mainly South also, West London, and they looked at the people that they looked, maybe not the same people, the same population now and in the 40s, what happens if they keep using those urban vernaculars. And they found that they do in certain contexts.
Yes, maybe as people get older, they acquire different styles, and this would be a style they would use for people from the same background as themselves.
Yeah.
It depends what happens to them as they go through life, doesn't it? It depends what what kind of situations they find themselves in, who they interact with. And these were very deprived, from very deprived areas. These people didn't know what would happen to them.
I think
it
would be very interesting to, obviously, you'd have to know the other language a lot of the young people speak at home. Be very interesting to also see how it develops with age, because I myself, English is not my first language, and when I speak to my parents, it happens to me all the time that I can't forget, I can't seem to remember certain words, and I tend to use an English term. So I think it'd be very interesting to see how it progresses in terms of the mother language.
It's quite nice in a way because it gives us lots of ideas for more research which needs to be done. It's sort of rather frustrating at the moment while we're waiting for the research to be done and we don't know the answers to these questions, but yes, I agree.
Can I ask a slightly different question? I found really interesting the description of the larger context in Paris and UK, especially the educational context. And I thought, oh, in Paris, it's so depressing that it's all the assimilation and they have to exclude the home language and then put them in special classes. But then maybe that works, because you consider that they talk about, they acquire the standards, they talk about their schoolwork, they stay in school, they travel. So maybe that works?
Yeah, do you know, while I was preparing this talk, I was thinking to myself, my goodness, I think I'm going to be arguing against multiculturalism. I don't really want to argue against it. I think what you can say about London is that you have ended up with a very integrated group of young people. I mean, they all speak the same. Ethnicity is really not relevant to the young people that we spoke to. So there has been, that is quite an achievement, I think. On the other hand, I don't know what it's done for their job opportunities. If they, the other thing that we don't know is we don't know how they, whether they style switch very much if they go to, if they go for a job interview, for example. We don't know whether they start speaking in a different way or not. And I think Rob Drummond said that in Manchester he did role plays with the young people, so they kind of got them to kind of train for interviews or to pretend they were having an interview, and they did style switch quite a lot. So maybe.
Mm-hmm. It will end up with writing. I think the language, particularly young people are using or making up, you know, these new words that you think about, it's really creative. I remember when I was doing a workshop in a secondary school in where I live, in the East End, and I heard this term that they were directing towards a teacher called waste man.
Oh yeah.
And which is essentially someone who's no good. Unfortunately, it was, you know, directed towards the teacher. But it's interesting how they come about. How's it come about, do you think?
I think so. Our young people use waste man and batty man, and I think it's from Jamaican Creole. It's just interesting that a lot of the vocabulary it seems to be from Jamaican Creole in London rather than from other places. But we wonder if it's because Jamaicans were the first immigrant group to come, you know, in the 50s. They were the largest group and they were the first group. And people who study Creole communities talk about the founder principle. So the idea is that the people who came first are the ones who kind of lay the foundations, and then their language kind of stays. But it seems to be only, well, I was going to say it's only in vocabulary, but actually a lot of the vowels are very much like Jamaican Creole as well. But of course the trouble is they're also very much like Indian English and learner English and so on. So I think maybe in terms of vocabulary, that explains why these Jamaican Creole terms have survived. But the other features, I think they may have come from Jamaican Creole, but they've also been very much reinforced by the other kind of varieties of English that are spoken by the learner varieties of English, because these are all features of learner English as well. So maybe that also has contributed to multicultural Latin English emerging as well.
Did you look in any way at the social stratification of the speakers?
We assumed that they were all pretty much the same, in that they were all from council housing estates, and their parents either didn't work or in prison. It was quite a deprived area, as I said. So I think they were very much towards the lower end of the social spectrum. But we have come across people from the other end of the social spectrum, and these are the ones who start shift. Start using multicultural London English features when they want to, you know, talk about being tough.
Yeah, street cred.
Exactly, street cred, yes. Yeah. So I think it's got a social meaning.
Just an idea for the style shift, and I think our students would be a great resource, because,
yes.
I mean, this is not based on anything but my own impression,
yes.
But I'm convinced a lot of the students in my class are style shifting. They would be talking much more multicultural London English outside class. Some of them don't, some of them speak it in class, but the majority don't.
Yes.
But I know that more of them do, I believe, more of them do outside class than they do in.
Yes.
So there could be a project using students joining in on the team and recording themselves.
That would be a great thing to do. I mean, some of these features that my students say they use them, so I've been saying these are, you know, used by people in Hackney, and they all say, no, I use man. And I use this as me, they say as well. But and some of their vowels are maybe not quite as short as the ones that we recorded, but they're certainly tending in that direction.
So
I think it may be, I mean, what you would expect if it is going to be a lasting way of speaking is it would spread up the social spectrum, and so maybe it's doing that. You'd expect it to spread out to other places as well, so I don't think you would expect it necessarily to go to Manchester just yet.
I think if we don't have any other questions, I think we really, really like to thank you for coming.
Thank you. Thank you for coming.
It's been
fantastic.
So thank you very much.